Okay, so let's continue. So far, we have been looking at executing multiple tasks, processes, threads in multiple processor units. But today, we'll look at how we can execute multiple threads within a single processor. So we'll look at not only how it can be executed in a single processor, but also multi-core. So before that, let me just tell a line from Seymour Cray, who is a very famous personality as far as parallel computing is concerned. He was actually the brain behind the Cray computers. So he had once remarked that if you were plowing a field, which of the following options you would rather use? Would you like a strong ox or 1024 chickens? Actually, if you are plowing the field, then you might prefer a strong ox because 10,024 chickens would be of very little use. But if you are thinking of a computing problem, your answer would be different. 1024 chickens, we will see, would be much more valuable than a strong ox. So, with this premise, we'll do the today's discussion. And once in a while, you will just refer back to this statement. So let's see how multithreading support can be provided within a single processor. So far, we have considered different threads running on different processors. So how do we do that? But before that, let's see that what would be the motivation? Why do we want to execute multiple threads in a single processor? One straight answer is that it would be inexpensive because multiple processors would cost multiple times the cost of a single processor. Here, we would rather than replicating processors, we'll try to make efficient use of the resources within the single processor, and it would be much more inexpensive, less costly compared to having multiple processors. The other thing is that even if you have multiple processors, it takes considerable time, communication time, to communicate among separate processors. But if you are able to run multiple threads within a single processor, then communication would be very fast. So these are the two main motivations behind multithreading within a single processor. Actually, we have been discussing the superscalar processors, and we said that the superscalar processors are being used extensively. Almost every processor you use is a superscalar processor. And we had seen that a superscalar processor works by replicating the functional units, there are multiple functional units. But the problem is that in the superscalar processing, most of the processors' functional units can't find enough work on the average, and most of the time, majority of the functional units will be idle. So here is a figure from some experimentation. We said that even though it is a superscalar processor of degree 6, but on the average, the instructions per cycle is only 1.5. So you can see the inefficient utilization of the functional units. So it may be a good idea to execute multiple threads within the single processor because threads share resources. Actually, executing multiple processes would not be meaningful because they don't share resources, right? Can you appreciate that? Why we can't execute multiple processes in a single processor, whereas multiple threads in a single processor? What would happen if we execute multiple processes instead of threads? Anybody would like to answer this question? Why should switching time increase?
Because all the, I think, like all the data and the stacks have to be.
Okay, let me just tell this, that when a context switch between processes occurs, then they refer to different data items, and as a result, there will be too many cache misses, right? Too many cache misses. Do you see that point? Here, they share the same address space, right? So whatever is there in cache is also shared by them, majority of that, right? We'll see the further problems later. But just imagine here that the address space is shared, whereas on the other hand, the address space among processes is not shared, right? So first, let's look at why do the idle cycles occur in a superscalar processor, and we'll investigate how can we make them busy. Why are the functional units idle in a superscalar processor, and what can we do to make them busy? Let's consider a typical processor, superscalar processor, where we can issue up to 4 instructions per cycle. And of course, to be able to issue 4 instructions per cycle, we will need several functional units, like several adders, several multipliers, floating point unit, things like that. And the thing is that many times due to dependency, we might not issue 4 instructions, right? Due to dependencies among instructions, many times we might be able to issue 1, 2 or things like that. And this becomes specially aggravated when there is a cache miss, either L1 or L2 cache miss. We know that when there is a page fault, there has to be a context switch, isn't it? But L1 or L2 cache miss, we will introduce idle cycles, because even though we are speculatively executing, we can't really execute as far as we wish. There is a limit to speculative execution, right? So in presence of cache miss, the number of instructions that can be issued might be 0, because there is a limit up to which you can speculatively execute. So in a superscalar execution, we had seen that the dispatcher section reads instructions and decides which can run in parallel, making some dependency analysis. And the number of instructions that can be issued per cycle is limited by instruction dependencies and long latency operations like L2 cache miss, right? So these are two sources of idle cycles in a superscalar processor. One is the dependency, which restricts the number of instructions that can be issued per cycle. The other is long latency events, like it needs to wait for certain things, data to arrive, and so on. Yeah. No. Here we are saying many of the modern processors typically issue 4 instructions per cycle. So they are superscalar processors of degree 4. But speculative execution, we had seen while discussing about speculative execution that we might not really execute any instruction that gets ready, because there will be wastage of work, right? And also there is extent to which you can store data, hide data without reflecting it. Yes. Of course, we had seen speculative execution, and we had said that speculative executions are almost used in every processor, because that is a means of increasing the throughput and making the functional units busy, that we had already seen. Now let's see, but still, in spite of speculative execution, there are idle units, there are idle cycles, and we saw the figure is quite bad, like 6 instructions can graduate per cycle. But if you observe a typical application running in a superscalar processor, see that only about 1.5 graduate, right? So the main culprits here are the dependencies and long latency events. So if we further analyze the source of processor inefficiency, this is a superscalar processor of degree 4, right? 4 instructions can be issued at any time. If we look at the idle slots here, we will see that there are two kinds. One is the vertical waste, right? Just see here, we issued nothing here, right? There is a vertical waste. And also there are horizontal waste. Sorry, this is not the vertical, these are the vertical waste where nothing has been issued. And in these instructions have been issued, but only partially. Just see, only here we could issue 4. 4 are getting executed simultaneously, right? So why do vertical wastes and horizontal wastes occur? Horizontal wastes occur because we can't find enough instructions to issue, right? Even though it is 4, we are issuing less. The vertical wastes, I mean, I am telling in a very simple word, there are more to it than what I am saying. So, at a very simplistic view, the horizontal wastes occur because of the dependencies among instructions. We can't issue too many instructions, can't find too many instructions to issue. Whereas the vertical waste occurs because we might have to, due to the long latency events like L2 cache miss and things like that, sometimes we don't issue anything at all. Sometimes, as we will see, sometimes we might have to flush the pipeline also, right? So that's the reason behind vertical waste. So vertical waste occurs when we can't issue any instruction in a cycle, possibly due to a long latency event like a L2 miss. Whereas horizontal waste is introduced when we can't find that many instructions to issue in a cycle. But if we analyze this for a typical application, we will see that on the average, the majority of the wastes are due to vertical waste, 61% for average applications. That is the percentage of vertical wastes. Yes? Right. In a superscalar processor, only one thread is active. That's the premise with which we are discussing all these analysis of a super inefficiency of a superscalar processor. We're not yet started discussing multithreading. So let's see how we can do multithreading to be able to reduce this wastes. So the idea is simple. If we just take one thread of execution and we start issuing, we'll encounter many branches, and we know that we can't really speculate too much and go on issuing. And also, as we issue as from a single thread, we'll encounter the long latency events, right? So rather than investing more in speculation and so on, because after all, speculations will once in a while go wrong, and we would waste all the work that is done. So rather than enlarging the depth by using better speculation techniques and so on, it's a good idea to enlarge the width or multiple threads to achieve better utilization of the functional units. So it is basically a latency hiding technique. What we mean here is that whenever there is a long miss, when there is a long stall due to cache miss and things like that, we issue from other threads who keep the functional units busy. So when one thread is having difficulty in keeping the functional units busy due to long latency events or maybe due to data dependency, that time we will keep the functional units busy by executing instructions from other threads. So here, under cache miss or data dependency, etc., we will be able to keep the functional units busy. But what do we need to be able to support multithreading in the superscalar processors? What extra thing do we need? One thing, of course, that every thread has a state. The state, as we had seen on the basic ideas about threads, that we need separate program counters for the threads, we need separate register files and flags, and we need per thread renaming table, because we are discussing dynamically scheduled processors, right? We need renaming tables. So these are the hardware burden that we will have to incur to be able to execute multiple threads on the same processor. So these will keep track of the state, program counter, register file, and per thread renaming table. And since the modern processors are dynamically scheduled, register renaming would be able to give unique register identifiers for different threads. Otherwise, there will be a mix-up, isn't it? Because two threads might refer to the same register and so on. There might be a mix-up, but here we are able to give unique names to every register access by register renaming. And therefore, instructions from multiple threads can be mixed in the data path. In the most basic form, we will see that the processors interleave executions from different threads. We'll look at this, how do they, what are the different types of multithreading. But roughly, we can say that there are three types of multithreading. One is coarse-grained multithreading, fine-grained multithreading, and the simultaneous multithreading. And due to obvious advantages, most of the modern processors use the simultaneous multithreading. But to be able to appreciate the advantages of simultaneous multithreading, let's look a little bit about coarse-grained and fine-grained multithreading, because once even these were supported in the processors. First, let's look at the easiest, the coarse-grained multithreading. So here, one thread continues to run at any time. But whenever this thread encounters a long stall, a thread switch occurs. So one thread continues to run as long as it can. Instructions are issued from a single thread, but when it encounters a long stall like L2 cache miss, then another thread is run. So we will see that this form of multithreading only hides long latency events, but dependencies among instructions, etc., it is not able to handle. But the advantage of this kind of multithreading, coarse-grained multithreading, is that it is very simple to implement. And here, whenever there is a long latency event, like a L2 cache miss, we would need to flush the pipeline. Why is that necessary? Can anybody answer this question? When there is a long latency event, we not only switch the thread, but also flush the pipeline of the instructions that were already executing from that thread. Yes, anybody would like to answer this question? Okay, it's not difficult. See, the thing is that we are speculatively executing these instructions. We can't let these instructions complete and update the registers and things like that. We are speculatively executing, and we'll not be able to update this, right? And we can't also speculatively execute too long, that we had already said. So we can't hide this in the processor too long. So it's better to flush it and start a new instruction. It will make it very complicated and inefficient if we try to save this much work by incorporating additional support in the processor, right? Do you see the point? Because we're not sure when it will again start executing, and we can't really update it because these are speculatively getting executed, right? So it's better to flush the pipeline and start another thread. So whenever there is a context switch, we might have to flush the pipeline, and you will again notice the empty slots, right? So the vertically empty slots would appear because of the context switches. There are many implementations of the coarse-grained multithreading. For example, the Sun Spark 2 processor implemented the coarse-grained multithreading, and it provides context for up to 4 threads. And out of these 4 threads, one thread is reserved for interrupt handling. And then the 32 general purpose registers is replicated for all the 4 threads. Right? That's why a fast switching can take place. Fast thread switching can take place because the registers are replicated. And coarse-grained multithreading makes sense in cache coherent, implementing cache coherent distributed shared memories. Why is that? Because on a cache miss to a remote memory, which takes quite a bit of time, we can switch to a different thread, and the network messages could be handled by the interrupt handler. So here, a fine-grained multithreading would not make too much of sense for implementing a cache coherent DSM. Now let's look at a fine-grained multithreading. Here, out of all threads that could be executed, the processor selects only a few, called as the active threads. Yes. Yes. Okay, let me just explain it, since some of you have not understood. In a coarse-grained multithreading, one thread is selected at any time, and that thread, instructions are issued from that thread until that thread encounters a long stall. So at any time, instructions from one thread are under execution, and as long as there is a long stall, rather than waiting, we just switch threads. Same process. These are the threads which share context. That's why you are able to do a thread switching. Otherwise, we'll have to do a process switching. In fine-grained multithreading, we will have several active threads. Out of all the threads that are ready for execution, we'll select 4 or something like that. Now, there is a context switch among the active threads on every clock cycle. So here we'll be able to reduce the horizontal wastes and also the vertical wastes further, right? Instead of executing just one thread and then switching it on a long latency event, we will switch every cycle between the different threads. But at any cycle, only one thread is executing, right? So here we issue instructions only from a single thread. But again, we'll see that it is not the best solution. We might not completely fill the horizontal units, because one thread, we might not find 4 or so instructions to be issued at the same time. 3 might be issued, 2 might be issued from a thread. But cache misses would be tolerated here, long latency misses. It hides both long and short latency events. Vertical waste is eliminated because no need to totally flush the cache. But horizontal wastes we'll see are not. The horizontal wastes are not eliminated due to two reasons. One is that instructions from one thread are issued, so we might not find so many instructions in that thread. The other thing is that when one thread undergoes a long latency stall, then we might have to flush that thread. One thread we might have to flush. If a thread has little or no operation to execute, the issue slot will be underutilized. So this is the kind of occupancy we'll get. The vertical wastes have been reduced, but still there are quite a bit of horizontal waste. Now let's look at the simultaneous multithreading, and we have been saying that this is the one which is being used, the modern processors. To think of it, this is different from the other kinds of multithreading because it converts thread level parallelism into instruction level parallelism. So the idea here is that even in one cycle, we issue instructions from multiple threads, and as a result, we'll have highest probability of finding work for every issue slot. Both horizontal and vertical wastes will be reduced to the greatest extent. So this simultaneous multithreading technique, Intel has given its own name, it refers to as hyperthreading. To look at a conceptual understanding of this, in superscalar, we had lots of wastes of the horizontal and vertical, and then we had looked at the coarse grained multithreading. In the fine grained, we could reduce the vertical stalls, but still we had quite a bit of horizontal idle units. But by using simultaneous multithreading, we could increase the occupancy to the maximum. But what are the implications of these different types of multithreading? We had said that the coarse grained multithreading is the easiest to implement. So here all resources are shared, excepting we have instruction fetch buffer, register file, and control logic, and the state, the flags, etc. They are not shared. We replicate that. So fetch buffers, register files, and flags, etc., they are replicated. Whereas in a fine-grained, all resources are shared excepting the register file and the control logic state. So even the instruction fetch buffers are shared. And in simultaneous multithreading, we'll see that all but the instruction fetch buffer, return address stack, register control, control logic state, reorder buffer, store queue, etc. are shared. We'll elaborate this further. And the advantage we had seen that a coarse grained multithreading, it switches on long stalls, switches between threads, whereas in a fine grained multithreading, it switches between threads every cycle. But in simultaneous multithreading, we don't do explicit thread switching. All the threads are active and being executed. The advantages of simultaneous multithreading are obvious. We reduce memory stalls, pipeline flushes due to incorrect speculation, and so on. And here we eliminate these and keep the units busy. To think of it, the extra hardware that you need for supporting multiple logical CPUs where multiple threads execute is very minimal, because essentially you will have to replicate the registers, and you will have to replicate the flags, and so on. So only 5% extra silicon to duplicate the thread state. Definitely it will be better than single threading, increased thread level parallelism, improved processor utilization, things like that. Of course, as we are talking of the ox and the chicken, it is not as good as two separate CPUs. Each one would incur stalls, right? It would work slowly. Each of the thread would work slowly if compared to if it had worked on a single processor. So this is the pictorial representation of a simultaneous multithreading. We have a blue thread and a red thread, and then the instruction scheduler schedules these threads, and some of the blue instructions from the blue thread have been issued out, and some from the red thread have been issued out. Now let's look at some issues in the simultaneous multithreading. So here, even though we said that it is so simple that only little bit of replication and so on, but we'll see that we need to extend, replicate, and design some units. We'll just look at that. Even at the concept, even though the conceptual level, we just said that some replication is there and that's all, but we'll see that there is more to it than just replicating the states of the threads. So we also need in addition to replicating the context register species, etc., we need per thread mechanism for pipeline flushing and subroutine returns, because we might, when there is a speculation is wrong, long stalls, etc., we might need to flush the pipeline of one thread, keeping the other threads alive. We also need per thread branch target buffer and translation look aside buffer. Why is that? Why do we need per thread branch target buffer and translation look aside buffer? Can anybody answer this question? Any other answer? Okay, the answer is not difficult. See, the thing is that the branch prediction might be different for different threads, right? Even though it may be same instructions and so on, different threads might behave differently with the branches, right? And also, they might refer to different addresses, even though they share the address space, but they might be using different addresses. It is possible. So, translation look aside buffer might have to be replicated. See, here we are saying that why do we replicate the branch target buffers and translation look aside buffers? We said that even though the instructions might be same, the conditional instructions might be the same, but the behavior of the different threads might be different for those branches, right? One thread, the branch might be taken, another thread, the branch, that same instruction branch may be untaken, right? And also, it is not necessary that all the threads, they execute the same instructions and same data and so on. So, they might access, the different threads might access different data, even though the data might be shared, but still at any time, they might be operating on different data items. And as a result, we need to have separate translation look aside buffer, because if we combine the translation look aside buffer for the different threads, there will be too many misses in the TLB, right? Because they behave differently, they are accessing different data. And the resources that need to be redesigned are the instruction fetch unit and the processor pipeline. Now, let's see what is involved here. And as far as instruction scheduling is concerned, we don't really need additional hardware, because the register renaming would be the same as a superscalar processor, because after we have renamed it, they will have unique names and we can just mix them. If this is the pictorial representation of a superscalar architecture, we had investigated this during our discussions, that we will have instruction fetch unit, and we can issue instructions. We have a single PC because we are at any time handling one thread in a superscalar architecture. And then there are reservation stations for different functional units, and they are executed speculatively, right? Just see this line here. They are executed speculatively without really getting reflected in the register file, and then once they are committed, then they are reflected in the register file. We had seen this picture, this schematic earlier, right? But now, if we want to make this superscalar into multi-threaded, we need to have replicate program counters, right? We need to replicate the program counters, we need to replicate the commit units, and of course the registers and so on, register files, maybe we should have shown it here separately, right? So, that's just for understanding. Now, let's see how simultaneous multithreading can work. Let's look at a very simplistic model of simultaneous multithreading. Here, we can fetch one instruction from two threads, very simple case. Let's consider a very simple case. Then decode one instruction, one thread, till we encounter a branch or end of the cache line, and then jump to the other. And of course, because multiple threads are under execution at any time, we'll have to give highest priority to threads having fewest instructions in the decode, renaming and queue pipeline stages. The main idea here is that we reduce the speculative execution, right? We don't let any thread execute too much speculatively. Of course, to be able to implement this, we will need a small hardware overhead in the form of tracking the queue lengths for different instructions. But let's just look at one implication of simultaneous multithreading. We said that there will be multiple registers for different threads, right? For example, if each thread has 32 registers, then the register file will have 32 into the number of threads. If there are 4 threads, this will be 128, isn't it? A large register file would result in longer access time. And this is the reason why we need to restructure the pipeline. I think it is here. Just see here that we have 2 register read here. Because of the longer access time to the register, we have 2 register read. Similarly, register write. Okay, so that's a bit of implication of having a large set of registers for different threads. And okay, so we have 2 cycle register reads, writes, and so on because of the large number of registers. But which instruction to issue in a cycle? Here, it's slightly different than what we were doing in superscalar. In superscalar, the oldest is the best because that will be having the least speculation. But here, the branch speculation optimism can vary across threads. For some threads, speculative execution would work very well. For some other thread, it might not work so well. So even if we speculatively execute one thread to a large extent, we might be gainer, unlike a superscalar execution where we had just one thread under execution. So several strategies for selecting instructions have been suggested. Branch speculated last, oldest first, several of them. I'm not going to discuss this. But what kind of compiler optimizations can be tried? One is that we should try to minimize cache interference, because the lower level caches would be shared, right? Sorry, all the caches are shared, L1, L2 caches are shared. So if they access 2 different data and instructions, there will be too many misses, right? So somehow the compiler should try to execute those threads which work mostly on the same instruction, similar data, and so on. And speculation should be enhanced. And here, unlike the multiprocessor, where we're trying to see how data sharing can be reduced and so on, we're given some compiler optimization techniques to restructure the code to be able to reduce data sharing. Here, data sharing is good because there is almost no overhead for data sharing among threads. But here, the same L1, L2 caches are shared among threads, and as a result, each thread would incur a performance degradation. Whatever you do, there will be little bit of performance degradation. And in the worst case, when the different threads access entirely different data and instructions, there can be even cache thrashing. As a result, a single thread performance is likely to go down, because not only that, there can be cache misses, increased cache misses, even the okay, I think the cache misses are one of the major performance degradation. And sometimes if we have branch predictors, even though we said that the branch predictors are etc. are separate, but in case they are shared, then there will be problem. So I think don't consider these points here, branch predictor etc., because normally they are separate. But how do we reduce this? One thing is that we should be able to assign priority to threads. Like some thread, we don't want it to get delayed by the other threads. So we should be able to assign priority to threads. And experimental data for the simultaneously multi-threaded processors shows good result for simultaneous multi-threading of 4, you can get throughput improvement of 2 to 4, right? Good improvement, you're able to keep the resources busy. Commercial examples are many, starting from Compaq Alpha with 4 thread, Intel Pentium 4, 2 thread, 30% gain reported, Sun Ultra 2 core, sorry, it's a 2 thread, okay, each core is 2 thread simultaneously multi-threaded, IBM Power 5, 8-way superscalar, 20% area growth, and so on. Those are some data. Now let's look at Pentium 4, a specific case of hyper-threading. So here, as we are saying that there are 2 threads which can execute simultaneously, and here the operating system operates as if it is executing on a 2 processor system. But when only one available thread is there for the program that we are running, then Pentium 4 behaves like a regular single-threaded superscalar processor. So for average applications, not written specifically for improving the performance of a hyper-threaded processor, even then, a 30% improvement has been noticed. Now let's look at multiple executions in a uniprocessor through a different approach, multicore. So here, we improve the execution rate of a single thread, but we try to maximize even the single thread. For example, out of order execution, speculation, all those are taken place, but we replicate the cores also. One of the major motivations behind the multicore architecture, as we were discussing some time back, that it can, the main motivation is that it can reduce power consumption. And we'll see that the Intel's multicore architecture doesn't use the net burst, it uses a core architecture which has derived from the Pentium M. It's a 12-stage pipeline, unlike the P4, which is a net burst architecture, which micro architecture with 30 stages. And here we'll see that power minimization has become a priority. We are talking of the problems with power dissipation and so on. And to reduce the wasted work, the branch predictors have been improved to a large extent in the multicore architectures. Just to have a thought on the power consumption, just see here, we are looking at the power density. We have been so far saying that they consume 100 watts and so on. Just think of the power density. In a small area, if you are dissipating too much of power, then it would be very difficult, it will, right, to dissipate that power. Just see here, the processor power dissipation watts per centimeter square has continuously been rising, and it has exceeded the hot plate with Pentium 3 processor, and then it is approaching with 0.6 nanometer, etc., the nuclear reactor, rocket nozzle, and so on. This data was given by former Intel fellow Fred Polak, who said that the power density, not the power dissipation, but the power density has surpassed hot plate power density in the 0.5 micrometer technology, and it is not too long to reach the nuclear reactor power dissipation levels, power density levels. Hot plate is cooking. Normally heaters, etc., we use heater coils in India, right? But in Western countries, they don't use a heater coil in the way we use. They use a hot plate, right? That lasts longer than our heater coils. But it's essentially a heater, right, for cooking. Now, let's look at the Intel's dual core architectures. The earliest Intel dual core was the Pentium D, but Pentium D is a misnomer actually, because it had simply two Pentium 4 CPUs. We will not go into details about how it worked and so on. Those who are interested can read up, but it's not really accurate to call this as dual core, because even though two Pentium 4 are there, but they execute as separate processors, right? Inefficiently paired together to run as dual core. So what we said about register sharing, etc., they happen very differently here. But the Core Duo was the Intel's first generation dual core processor, and we said that it is based on the core architecture, unlike the NetBurst which was used in the Pentium D. Intel has slowly migrated to the Core I architecture, which is basically a Pentium 3-4 hybrid, and it was made for the laptops and desktops, the Core Duo. But again, the Core Duo, it did not really do a good work of sharing between the threads. The Core 2 Duo is the second generation core processor, and it is made for desktops and laptops and designed to be fast while not consuming nearly as much power as previous CPUs. And Intel has now dropped the Pentium name in favor of the core architecture. So if you look at the core processor, we'll just look a little bit detail about this, about the kind of heat dissipation and so on. The Core 2 Duo has been codenamed as Conroe by Intel. There are homogeneous cores here, and there is a bus interconnection between the different cores, and there is a shared on-die cache memory. We were discussing some time back about in context of multiprocessors, that whether sharing cache should be appropriate or not and so on, right? So here they are sharing the cache between the core 1 and core 2, and each core does out of order execution, reservation stations and so on. And the L2 cache is 2 MB. Actually, it is 4 MB, as we will see in the next slide, but many of the Intel Core 2 Duo come with 2 MB L2 cache. This is set associative, prefetch, all those things exist. The Core 2 Duo was launched in July 2006 and was a replacement for Pentium 4 and Pentium D CPUs. And as we are mentioning that now onwards, Intel only ships the multi-core processors. Intel claims that the Conroe, that is Core 2 Duo, provides 40% more performance at 40% less power compared to Pentium D. And all the Conroe processors are manufactured with a 4 MB L2 cache, but how come we sold only 2 MB? The reason is that due to manufacturing defects, the E6300 and E6400 versions are based on half of their cache being disabled. So rather than wasting the entire CPU, entire processor, they are selling it as a lower capability processor unit, the E6300 and E6400, where half of the cache is disabled. And we will see that slowly the different processor manufacturers are trying to reduce the rejection of chips based on manufacturing by inbuilt detection of faults and avoidance of fault. We'll just look at that little bit. So this is one example of that. They have just defective, the ones that have defect in the cache, they're just selling it as 2 MB L2 cache. The core processor specifications speed ranges from 1 gigahertz to 3 gigahertz. The front side bus speed from 533 million transactions to 1333 million transactions per second. We will see the front side bus for Intel is a major determiner of the performance. In a couple of slides, we will see that. This is inherent to the Intel architecture, the front side buses. It uses a 65 nanometer process and it sticks to the 86 instruction set, MMX, SSE, etc. are supported. And as we are saying that the micro architecture is not net burst, but it is the core micro architecture. And it comes in 1, 2 and 4 cores. Unfortunately, we are not able to spend time to investigate the core microarchitecture. But let me just tell little bit about the core microarchitecture. Here, as we are saying that it uses a shutter pipeline and it uses a technique called as instruction, micro instruction and macro instruction fusion. The idea is that if we can combine instructions, like we are saying that many of the instructions where we fetch data from the memory and use that in the that's the characteristic of a load store, isn't it? That we fetch data from memory and then use that as a register operand, those take two instructions. So here, those instructions are fused later during the processing. I don't know whether we have something on that, but I would request you to look at the core microarchitecture and prepare a report. Okay, those who could submit a good report on core microarchitecture, we will consider them for some bonus mark. And we will just briefly look at the core microarchitecture. But unfortunately, we are running out of time today. We will continue from this point in the next class. So let me take the attendance.